Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 2 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. Thanks so much for rocking with me. Really excited this episode. So last episode, I referenced a guy by the name of James Loomstein. He's the managing partner at Rogue Marketing, an agency out of Dallas, Texas, and he's also an adjunct professor at the Southern Methodist University's Cox School of Business. And so I heard him on another podcast, and he was just a really prime example of someone who's working in the field and also teaching at the collegiate level, because one of the criticisms you hear about college internet marketing programs that, you know, these guys don't know what they're talking about, those who can't teach, blah, blah, blah. But no, this is a guy who's doing the real thing and teaching at the same time. And through the power of LinkedIn and some good old-fashioned networking, I was able to get him on the show. So this show is going to be my interview with Mr. James Loomstein, again, a managing partner at Rogue Marketing, an adjunct professor at Southern Methodist University Cox School of Business. Let's get to it. James, thanks so much for talking to me.
Oh, thank you very much for having me. It's a real pleasure to get together and talk a little digital marketing with you.
Absolutely. So the road to digital marketing tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. When did you get bit by the bug, and how did you become chanted with digital marketing?
How I got chanted with digital marketing.
Yeah, I meant to say enchanted, but
you know, enchanted. I think I've always been enchanted with digital marketing, ever probably since I was a kid. I've always had that entrepreneurial spirit and marketing. Some people in middle school and high school always go out and try and get the job at the local mall or, you know, the restaurant or delivering pizzas. I went out and did the lawn care or the landscaping, or how can me and my buddies go out and make money doing something. And so I think that really taught me a lot about, you know, the negotiating side and selling things and pricing and, you know, promotion and, you know, how do we try and sell stuff, right? How do we get people to take money out of their pocket and put it in our pocket? And so that is where I kind of started. In seventh grade, my buddies and I were literally selling candy out of our backpacks in the bathroom. Like, that was our thing. Awesome. And so, you know, that was like the marketing side for me. And then fast forward to college, those were the classes that I really enjoyed the most, those in like the business law classes, the most. And then I went into the corporate side of after graduation. I didn't take your traditional path into marketing. I went more corporate in the consulting side. And then what actually got me back into the marketing side was going back to grad school back in the early 2000s at SMU. And then that got me into the hardcore marketing side, and then the agency side, working inside Omnicom. And then from there, I just kind of deep dive into agency world and then work my way out of agency world. And then obviously, and then starting my own agency.
Cool. So that was very, very illuminating. So when was the honeymoon over? When did it like hit you about, okay, crap, like this is a real thing. It's not a play thing. When did, you know, the reality check come in?
The reality check of running my own agency, or yes, the reality check of like working in marketing?
In general, either or.
So the reality of running your own agency, I think that being your own business, and I think there's a difference between being an entrepreneur, or as, you know, Gary Vaynerchuk says, of having entrepreneurial tendencies. I think there really is a big difference. I think that passion and hustle and, you know, that internal drive and, you know, what people call the self-awareness, I think is a very, very true thing. And I think what you have to give up, and it's not really like the hours you give up. I think it's the ability to let things go, the ability to stop thinking and worrying, or, you know, where's not the worrying about like, where's my next client going to come from, but it's the worrying about just stuff. So I remember when I worked in corporate, or I worked at an agency, you always had this like army of people behind you to do stuff, right? So you work in corporate America, you know, there's Bob from accounting, or Sally from travel, or John who helps you on projects all the time. And, you know, when you leave at 4 o'clock on a Friday afternoon, you're good. And you can just kind of check out and just go enjoy your Friday afternoon at happy hour, and Saturday go golfing with your buddies, and Sunday go watch NFL football a day. But when you're an entrepreneur and you run your own agency, like, that doesn't stop, and you just it never ends. So I kind of equate it to being in the water of an ocean, and like those waves just always keep coming at you. And I don't think that really matters if you're a $1 million agency or a $10 million agency or a $200 million agency, like, because your level of responsibility, it never gets less. And your ability to take care of people, take care of your clients, take care of your family, like, you never get less responsibility the more important you become or the bigger your company becomes. Like, it's never less than it was before. And I think you give up the ability to relax, but not in a like vacation mode, but the ability to just kind of like let go of things. I think that's the part where it happens, from working in corporate to running your own thing.
You ain't never lied. I wish somebody would have told me that like 10 years ago. But all right, that was very insightful. So if you had a time machine and you can go back in time and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum, what are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help you prepare for your career?
In terms of like the flux capacitor and making sure that we had enough plutonium and 1.1 gigawatts and all that.
Exactly.
I got you. So I think the biggest thing I'd probably tell myself is learn more younger, and not to steal another Gary thing, but if I could go back to when I was 22, I would have given up the big salary I thought I was getting going after that big job. I would have followed people, not positions. That would have been number one. And I think that's my biggest piece of advice I try and give to young people now, is follow people, not positions. I think it's so very, very important to them. I think probably the second thing I would do is I would have gone after a deeper skill earlier in my career, where, and I say this in a lot of podcasts actually, is you can either be a wandering generality or you can be a meaningful specific. And I spent too much of my career as a wandering generality, as I was way too broad, way too wide, and I wasn't deep in something. And so I'm a big sports fan, and I love watching championship teams now, and I love like the team component of the Golden State Warriors and the Cavaliers and the Patriots and all these great teams, and I love their coaches and all that. But what I really love is when, you know, it's the fourth quarter of a basketball game and they need that guy to come off the bench and shoot that three, like, they know who that 3-point kill shot's going to come from, or they know who's going to make that field goal, or they know who's going to get that pinch hit, right? So they know who to go to do that thing. And I think it's so important for young people to have that deep hardcore skill, and like, you're known for X. And I think too many people want to be so broad in general that they get lost and they can't be identified for anything. So I think that would be my second. And then I think my third piece of advice for young people is, you don't have to be the best in the world, you just have to be the best in your world. And I think it's probably more important to, especially in this day and age, it's probably more important to play the social game than it is to be the deep expert in the something. And so if you're sitting in your cube at your office or in your company, but you're not getting out playing the social game, the people who are like the B-plus people playing the social game, when it's all said and done, are probably going to be the ones that rise to the higher levels than the person who was like the A-plus person who just sat there and did their job all the time but never played the social game. And I think that's kind of the world that we live in today. And I think that goes across all industries and facets of life. And as fair or unfair as that is, sometimes you're not rewarded for getting the 100 on the test. Like, that's how it is in high school or middle school, but that's not how it is in the real world. Like, friends matter and relationships matter. And sometimes the business goes to the people who are not necessarily who don't necessarily always have the best ideas or are the quote unquote smartest. They're just the most relatable or have the best connections or the best people to be around. Like, those are sometimes the people that get the business, but they're not always the quote unquote the smart one. And so I think you have to have that balance. So those would probably be my biggest three piece of takeaways that I would go back to myself.
Excellent. Excellent. That's really excellent. Like, I'd have been so much further along in my career if someone would have told me that when I was 22. So just to recap, follow people, not positions. It's better to be a meaningful specific than a wandering generality. And you don't have to be the best in the world. You just have to be the best in your world.
Correct.
Excellent, excellent advice. Well, we are going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to hit Mr. Loomstein with some heavy hitters. So stay tuned. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry, this is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately, most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. All right, we are back. So, James, the first half was excellent, very insightful. I wish I could go back in time right now. I'd be a billionaire. Like, people wouldn't have my number right now if I knew that when I was 22. So we're gonna keep the train moving. You, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss are chilling at the bar after a conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking in the professional digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
I think the biggest thing that's missing is a glimpse into reality from the brand side. So number one, I think it's probably really unfair if you're a brand and you're the chief marketing officer of a company. I think you have a really hard job today. I think not only, you know, as I said on a previous podcast, but like, I think it's really hard to be that chief marketing officer today, and that you have to not only be responsible for the P&L and have to go off and deal with procurement, and you have to deal with, you know, if you work in the restaurant industry, about napkin thread count, or you have to worry about operational efficiencies and pricing models and et cetera. But then you also have to go out and figure out SEO and what's our bid strategy on Facebook ads and Google and how we're going to deal with programmatic. Like, you can't be an expert in all those things. And so if you were that chief marketing officer 50 years ago, you could only do five things in your life, you know, just direct mail, billboards, radio, TV, and print, and telling them that, you know, it's really not your fault and you have a really hard job today, that being the chief marketing officer of a brand is really, really hard today. So you can't be really responsible for procurement and operations and order fulfillment on one side, and then that afternoon going out and worrying about SEO and paid media and content and what's our strategy for going after this new programmatic display geo-targeting new tool that's out there. So I think that's number one. I think the second thing I'd be worried about is, how do we bring up this new crop of digital marketing people into this industry? I think there's been tools out there that have kind of not ruined marketing, but the perception of young people graduating out of college with marketing degrees about what they think marketing actually is. So if you're graduating from with a marketing degree in the 80s, you know, you were worried about the four P's, or you were worried about hierarchy of needs, or taking more psychology classes. But if you went and asked students today, and I'm an adjunct professor at SMU in Dallas, and they're talking about things like, well, how do I rank higher on Google, or the SEO value, or where do I get links from? I'm like, that's not really marketing. That's about manipulating search engines. Mm-hmm. So like, you need to take that out. Like, at some point, that becomes the non-factor back in marketing, and really influencing and helping people make buying decisions is what really is critical. And so the psychology of marketing is almost being devalued, almost like the creative directors and the creative side is being devalued inside of marketing. And the data scientist level is being held up on some level of higher pedestal today.
Right.
So I think that would be number two. And then I think the third thing is probably more around practicality. And I think that we get so lost in this pendulum of digital solves everything, and we're just going to throw a bunch of money at Facebook ads and Google ads and run PPC campaigns, and you know, stuff is just going to happen. And it just doesn't happen that way. And I think people have just been overpromised by the web. And that might have been the case in your early 2004s, 2008s, 2010s. But so many companies now are on the web, and there's so much messages, and there's so much noise and clutter. With every company there, getting to that audience, it's more science than it is art. And I think these companies need to realize that, like, you're almost better off going back to TV today. You're almost better off running radio spots. Like, there's almost less noise there than there is trying to fight through a Facebook feed or the noise of Twitter or getting your ad seen somehow on a Google display network. Like how does that work? And so I think those are the things. It's about education, understanding audiences, educating the market, and teaching young people about the practicality of marketing and what they really need to understand, and stop trying to manipulate search engines and really start to understand people. I think one of my biggest things is that nobody ever got fired for bringing in IBM to solve a business problem, but they will get fired for bringing in James's consulting company. And I actually have a couple of examples from my own personal life, and I think these are probably great life lessons for everybody else. And so if you're 30 years old, 40 years old, 50 years old, and you've worked in corporate America, and you've had that at png.com email address, or at Microsoft, or at Ford.com, or at insert Fortune 500 company.com email address for the last 10, 15, 20 years. Well, you've come accustomed to sending off emails to people and them responding back to you with a certain level of expectation and a certain level of, we're going to respect you because you're at this company and there's an entitlement and you have this position and we're just going to do because you're that. But when you leave that world and you go out on your own, you're just a person. And so what happens is people, when you're Bob at Accenture and Bob at Accenture walks into a company and says, we're here to solve your business challenges, that works. But when Bob leaves and goes out on his own and walks back into that same office and says, hi, I'm Bob, I'm here to do some consulting for you, they were charging you $700 an hour, but I'm only going to charge you $200 an hour, that doesn't work, because the person who signs that check, he still has to go to procurement, or he still has to go to finance, and he has to explain why he hired Bob and he didn't hire Accenture. And he's going to come back and say, sorry, Bob, I can't go with you. But I'm so much cheaper. I'm still the same person. It doesn't matter. Because Accenture has spent hundreds of millions of dollars building up their brand for the opportunity and the ability to charge that amount of money. And it doesn't matter if you charge a dollar. They're not going to go with you because they can't fight the risk. Because that person's job at that corporation, their job really isn't to do the project. Their job is really to try and not get fired. Like, right. That is really what their job is. And people in corporate don't really understand that when they're in the middle of it, they understand until they get out of it. And so two shining examples of that, when I was in graduate school at SMU, at Southern Methodist University in Dallas, I would try and get networking meetings with top execs here in Dallas in the business community. If I would ever email them from my Yahoo address at the time or whatever I was using in 2004, my emails would often go unanswered. The moment I emailed them from my smu.edu email address, automatic responses, "Hi, James, how can I help you?"
Right.
Example number one. Example number two is I went and worked at a consulting company on a brief project. I kept applying for speaker roles at agencies. And this one I was kind of up and coming in like 2006, 2007, 2008, somewhere, 2010, 2011, 2012, somewhere in there. I would apply for my digital space consulting email address. I would never get selected. The moment I took a position with a consulting company and they gave me an email domain and I applied for the same conference, I was automatically selected.
Right.
I was the same person. It was the same pitch. It was all about where it came from and how it was presented. And I think that people have a perception that it's going to be just as easy when they leave their corporate job and leave that environment when they go out on their own. And it's not that. And that is so true for consultants. I think the other disillusion for consultants is that they think that, oh, well, if I charge $100 an hour and there's, you know, 100 and there's 40 hours in a work week, well, I'm going to make $200,000 a year. And the reality is, of the 40 hours in a work week, you'll be lucky to get 20 billable hours in a work week. Mm-hmm. Because the amount of non-billable time that goes into a billable hour is insurmountable. That the amount of time it takes into creating a pitch or going to the meeting at Starbucks or driving across town or all those other tasks that were done by that army of people behind you in the corporate job, the person that helped with your travel or called when your internet went out or emptied your trash or did whatever, those people aren't there anymore and you have to do everything. And so all those things that made you very powerful in your current job or allowed you to be the best version of yourself and do those things, suddenly they're not there anymore. And all those hours still have to come from somewhere. And I think those are the two biggest things that people who worked in corporate America, who then want to go out on their own, those are the probably two of the most overlooked things that either are taken for granted or they just don't see that are right there in front of them.
Right. Man, that's powerful. That's real powerful because you are correct, because this whole digital marketing agency, it's a different beast entirely. Mm-hmm. And yeah.
And people still have to buy you. Like, you still have to sell. And some people just aren't good salespeople. Like, mm-hmm. You can be a really good marketer. You can be the best writer. You can be a great storyteller. You can put together amazing PowerPoints. People still have to buy you, right?
Right.
Like, you still have to make the pitch. And they still have to be comfortable enough to want to buy what you're selling. And so that's why I was saying, like, it's still like 70%. Some people say it's 60% relationships. I think it's like almost like 65% relationships and like 45% like knowing how to do the thing. Mm-hmm. But if you're like 95% doing the thing and you're like the expert in the thing and you're 5% the ability to relate and get along with people, you're going to lose. True. Especially story. Being on your own. That's why you're better off being in the back office somewhere of a corporation. Like, go sit in your cube or your corner office and make your six-figure salary. Stop trying to be an entrepreneur.
True story. Not a lot of people wants to hear, but it needs to be said. It needs to be said.
Go make a six-figure salary. Like, go do that. Stop watching Shark Tank and being like, I'm going to be the next thing. Because you're not.
Mm-hmm.
So,
true story.
True story. So, that's all.
That's really excellent. See, I knew there was a reason I liked you when I listened to the podcast, because I listen to a lot of podcasts. I listen to Carrie's podcast in specific, and just that insight and that willingness to tell it like it is straight. That's what, especially young people, that's what we need to hear. Yeah. Because a lot of folks just really have just a wrong idea about the industry in general, which is one of the reasons why we wrote our book, Beyond Buzzwords. But last question, and I'll let you go. But I got to take a minute to kind of set it up. So it's going to be a riff on the last question that John Lee Dumas asks on his podcast. But I'm steering it in a very specific direction, because from my perspective, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space. And by professional, I'm talking about someone who works in-house at a corporation or a brand, or works on the agency side. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, even though you could, you know, you could absolutely make a case that somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas are, you know, professionals. That's not what I'm referring to. So there's kind of three typical paths to being a pro digital marketer. Is one is just Googling it, and there's no guarantees that you land on solid information. Yes, there's lynda.com and Udemy and a bunch of good places, but you could just as easily find yourself in Amway, right? I mean, there's no guarantees there. You could do like I did and go get a bachelor's degree in internet marketing. Problem with that is it's very expensive and there's a longer lead time. So even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took me 30 months to complete, which is like an eternity in the digital marketing space. And then the most popular way that people educate themselves in terms of career trajectory is through conferences. The problem with conferences is that even though in aggregate it's less than, you know, going to Full Sail or where you teach, you have to have that money up front. Right. They don't take financial aid. So once you factor in the cost of the conference, plus your flight, plus your hotel, plus, you know, Uber back and forth and food for however many days, you're easily looking at, you know, $3,000 to $5,000 on a single conference. And that doesn't include any, like, you know, VIP training that they have, which in my experience can range anywhere from $10,000 on up. And so, like, there has to be a better way to get folks in the pipeline besides either just winging it on a search engine and hoping for the best, or going to these expensive conferences, or going to an even more expensive degree program. So now that I said all that, I'm finally going to get to the actual question. So imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all of these experiences, skills, and knowledge, but your food and shelter is taken care of. But all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Let me answer that question, and then I'm going to go back to your original hypothesis. Mm-hmm. The best way that I have ever, every job, I will tell you, every job I've ever had in my entire life has come through LinkedIn. I think LinkedIn is the most undervalued tool ever. Every job from, literally every job has come through that tool. And that is from, and I graduated undergrad in 1999. So after 99, every job from postgraduate school from 2004 on has come through LinkedIn. And I even mean like a consulting company out of Ohio, and I'm in Dallas, Texas, finds me online and was like, hey, we found you. Would you like to do a consulting project for me? The way I became an adjunct professor at Southern Methodist University, and you don't apply to be an adjunct professor in an MBA program, came through Twitter and LinkedIn. From their ability to find me and follow and see the type of content and community and everything I was putting out was my ability to work on a platform and create that opportunity. And no different than you and your ability to put out there. And I think 90% of the people online do absolutely nothing. 10% of the people make the content for 90% of the people to react to. So that's number one. But I think one of your first, so if I'm somebody and I have nothing, LinkedIn would be my number one resource in the professional world to connect with anybody. And then number two, I think it's a hustle game. And I think a majority of people out there don't really want to hustle. I think they all want to be on stage and nobody wants to put in the work. I think everybody wants to be the speaker up on stage. Everybody wants to be, well, let me put it that way. Everybody wants to play on Sunday in the NFL. But nobody wants to put in the work that those guys do Monday through Saturday.
Right.
And if you were to sit there, one of my favorite things is the Players Tribute, that website and that blog. If you were to just sit there and read what these players go through every week to be able to play on a Sunday, like, who wants that? It's terrible. Like, how much work and effort they have to go through to make that. One of the best quotes I ever saw was, it was a cornerback for the Atlanta Falcons who says, "I work 18 hours a day, Monday through Saturday, so I can suit up for 1 hour a day on Sunday." Mm. It's like every single day. And I don't think most people want to do that. And so every job I ever came through networking. Nobody ever got a job sitting at home waiting for the phone to ring. And I think it's about getting out there and hustling. And even when I was looking for full-time jobs, I never sat at home. Like, every morning I got up and I went to as many networking events as I could go to. Every morning I went to networking events at night. I went to luncheons. I went, how many coffees could I schedule? How many lunches could I schedule? Like, it was more about that than it was about submitting resumes online. And I think that's where opportunities come from. Like, people create their own opportunities. And I think it's no different. And the web creates that more than anything else. Like, I know that the more time I spend on LinkedIn connecting with people, or in my own fault, like, the more I would blog or send out stuff or connect or do things like this or get on more podcasts, the more activity creates more opportunity. Absolutely. And when I don't do stuff, like, nothing happens. So I shouldn't be shocked by the work I didn't do. Right. And I think everyone just wants to play on Sunday or be up at Carnegie Hall. Like, if you look at music artists like Coldplay or Maroon 5 or Kenny Chesney or insert big band here, none of them started off by playing that big concert venue. Everyone starts by playing the little venue. Like, nobody starts with the big venue. Mm-hmm. Gary Vaynerchuk did not start off the way he is.
Oh, absolutely.
I remember Gary Vaynerchuk 6 years ago in Dallas at a little thing with 200 people at it. Like, he was just a guy. Mm-hmm. Literally just a guy. And it's not like he has he's great and he's very motivational, but he didn't graduate with an advanced marketing degree from Northwestern and have a rich pedigree in journalism. Like, that's not him. And he'll be the first person to tell you that. Right. So we all took different paths to get here, right? Mm-hmm. But like, he works harder than everyone else and he keeps the pulse on the industry, but he also spends a majority of his time out talking with people, right, which I think is what gets him further ahead than anyone else.
Right.
Absolutely. And then the second part, all right. And then the second part to your question, mm-hmm, I think it's almost unfortunate that our industry of marketing and now digital marketing has been so romanticized to its own fault and its own detriment.
Yes.
That it's pulling people in who shouldn't be here. It's taking people from who were in different industries, and although those industries might have fallen on harder times, those people simply don't have the background, the experience, or what I call the hardcore skill to be successful in this industry. And I think that in order to be successful in marketing, you have to be one of a few things. I think you have to either be a killer writer, or you have to be killer on a coder, or you have to be a killer designer, graphic. Either you design really well, you code really well, or you write really well. Those three of that triangle, you have got to be really good at one of those three things. If you can't do one of those three things, then you cannot really be successful in this industry. And too many people have come into this industry, have seen how great it is on social media and been like, I can do this. And the reality is you can't. And someone wrote a movie and a guy put on a hoodie and they think they can do this and they can't. And it's sad. It's so sad.
Absolutely. I could not agree more. One of the great things about the industry is the low barrier to entry. One of the worst things about the industry is the low barrier to entry. So it really is a double-edged sword.
Right. I didn't go to law school because I don't like to read. Like, I think I'd be a great lawyer, but I don't like to read. And, like, that's one of the requirements for law school. You have to love to read, and you have to read a lot. I didn't want to do that. But to your point, there is a very low barrier to entry to be in this industry. Mm-hmm. And it's also so romanticized. Just like being an entrepreneur is so romanticized. And they make it sound so glamorous. But as you know, and I know, it's not glamorous. Like, it really isn't. Like, you could make so much more money and have so much less pressure going off and working for somebody else. Like, you could have your Fridays and Saturday, your Friday nights, Saturdays and Sundays off, right? Mm-hmm. And not have to worry about stuff. And you can make probably a lot more money doing it for somebody else. But you do it because you enjoy the hustle and the grind and you love the entrepreneurial spirit and all those things. Like, you ask for this world. But other people just get in because they watch a movie or the pendulum has come this way and it sounds cool, right?
Yep.
And just like marketing sounds cool. Marketing was not cool back in the 90s.
Oh, no, absolutely not.
Like, when I told people I was a marketing major, they're like, what is, like, why? Like, why would you do that?
Exactly.
Like,
like, don't you want a real job? Like, yeah.
Like, why aren't you a finance major like everybody else or an engineer or whatever? Like,
exactly.
Go get a real job. Exactly. Yeah. Like, literally go get a real job.
Exactly. I often tell people, like, I equate it to marriage, right? Because not mm-hmm. to say marriage isn't a good thing, because it can be a beautiful thing, but it's also one of the hardest things you'll ever do. And the reason I named the podcast Marketing Disenchanted, because it's kind of like falling in love, right? You mm-hmm. you meet this person that can do no wrong, they complete you, and then you actually move in or get married, and you find out that this person, you know, snores like a dying moose.
Yeah.
Or, you know, they leave all of the tops off of things, or they leave the cabinet door. You know what I'm saying? They put the toilet yeah. paper in the wrong way. Just something that irks you. And it's like, you know, that's when the honeymoon's over. And yeah. I think much more people need to hear this message earlier on. And that would save us all a lot of turmoil. So, James,
that wasn't in the brochure.
Right. Exactly. Like, yeah, this was supposed to be great. I was supposed to be a millionaire by now. Like, I was supposed to be a millionaire last week. What happened?
Oh, you know what's funny? You know what's great is so I have helped on this, like, starting a business class. And I will tell you that one of the first things that goes out is a questionnaire. And the amount of almost catastrophic delusion out there is you ask a questionnaire and you're like, how old are you? How much is your current salary now? And the average starting salary was like, the average salary in the room is like, let's just say 90 to 100,000 in the room. So mid-level manager type people, right? 90,000 salary. So some higher, some lower. And you ask them, like, you're here to start a business. They're like, yeah. I'm like, what is your level of expectation for how much money you're going to make in your first year? Unequivocally, everybody says they're going to make $1 million. How much are you going to make in year two? $2 million. How much are you going to make in year three? $5 million. They have no idea what small percentage of people make $1 million. Like, it is such a small, it's like asking a kid, like, I'm going to be in the NFL when you're growing up. I'm like, no, you're not.
Yeah.
Like, you're not going to be in the NFL. And I think the amount of delusion out there is the same as they watch a Shark Tank and they're like, that's going to be me.
Mm-hmm.
And it is so sensationalized by everybody. And it's just, it's not the same. And those people would be better off, like, go back and be a corporate job.
Yeah.
Like, this isn't for you. Like, this role is not for everybody. And the deeper you get into it, and the more people you hire, and the higher up you get, the less it's for everybody else.
Exactly. 1%, that when you look at the NFL or the NBA, you're mm-hmm. looking at the top 1% of the sport. So that mm-hmm. means the other 99% didn't make the cut. So,
yeah.
You know, but nobody tells these kids that, because they don't want to be mean or hurt their feelings, or everybody gets a participation trophy. Like, no, 1% of you is going to the NFL. Just one.
Yeah.
So yeah, man, this has been great. This has been illuminating. It's gonna do a lot of good to a lot of people, I think, or at least that's the
I hope
intent.
so. Yeah.
Where can people find you? Do you have any courses coming out? Tell us, tell us where to get a hold of you.
I think the best place is you can always follow on Twitter at Jay Loomstein. You can follow Rogue, my agency. So the website is gorogue.net. You can follow us on Twitter at Rogue Think. And those are probably the two best places to follow us.
Cool. Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for your time. This has been awesome. And yeah, man, keep killing it.
Thank you very much. Greatly, greatly appreciate it.
Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later, you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results. And you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.